Hi, everyone. Great to see that so many of you decided to take some time out of your no doubt busy Friday evening to come here. My name is Myra. I'm going to be the person hired to try to make sure that we keep to our allotted time slot, which honestly I'll probably fail at, judging by our talk yesterday, but I'll do my best. And this would, of course, be made a lot easier, but considerably more dull if it wasn't for our guest of honor tonight, George Monbiot. If you can have a round of applause. So George, for those of you who aren't familiar, is a columnist in The Guardian. He is an environmental activist. He has written several books. Among those, the latest one, Regenesis, How to Feeding the World Without Devouring the Planet. And that's basically what we're here to talk about today. I also feel honor-bound to tell you, even though we won't have time to go into it, that he at one point co-wrote a conceptual album about loneliness. And I still haven't had time to talk about it, but maybe some other time. Right. Really great to see you again. I'm thinking for tonight, last afternoon, we were in Uppsala at the university, and obviously we had some researchers and people like that, and they felt like they might be more interested in sort of the technical side of what you're proposing in your book. But today we're in basically the culture house of Stockholm. And it's also Friday, and I feel like there's no real better time to talk about revolutionary politics. Yeah. So I'm thinking we should focus a bit more on that today, if
sure.
That's fine with you.
Yeah, sounds good.
But we can start, just try to tell us a little bit about your book. So Regenesis is about the massive damage that farming does to the environment, and you propose some changes for how we could both feed a lot more people, because hunger is rising in the world, even though we're producing a lot more food, but you're also proposing some other changes. Do you want to?
Sure. So thank you very much, Myrna, and thank you everyone for coming. You know, we've been very good at campaigning against the fossil fuel industry and the chemicals industry and the plastics industry. and it's quite right that we do. You know, we are facing a multiple crisis caused by multiple powerful actors, and we should be taking them all on. But there is one industry we tend to leave alone, and it is food production. And it's wrong that we leave it alone, because it happens that food production is the most destructive environmental industry of all. It's responsible for the most habitat destruction and deforestation of any industry, the most wildlife loss, the most species extinction, the most water use, the most land use, the most soil degradation, and it's one of the top causes of climate breakdown, of water pollution and of air pollution. Now, obviously, we need to eat, and everybody needs food, and we need food production. But we need to be looking harder at this subject than we do at energy. We also need energy, but we all accept, I'm sure, in this room, that we need radically to transform our energy systems. We also need radically to transform our food systems. And there's one aspect of the food system which is far more damaging than any other. And it's the aspect missing from that cover. It is livestock farming. Livestock farming produces roughly 18% of our calories, but it does the vast majority of that damage that I'm talking about. In fact, even in climate breakdown terms, livestock farming produces roughly 20% of all greenhouse gas emissions. That's more than all global transport. In fact, if you're looking at this purely from the climate point of view, there are only two things you need to do to stop climate breakdown: leave fossil fuels in the ground and stop farming animals. It's as simple as that. Everything else is detail. And so it's quite striking that in 27 climate summits, we've never had a declaration from any of them on either subject. They've never mentioned leaving fossil fuels in the ground or stopping farming animals. They had two jobs. They haven't mentioned either of them. Hmm. It's an extraordinary situation. And in fact, and the very fact that we're at COP27 is a sign of abject failure. There would have been no COPs 2 to 27 if they intended to sort it out. They would have done it at COP1. Mm. It's what they did with ozone depleting substances. One summit in Montreal, problem solved, because they intended to solve it. In this case, they intend to keep us talking so that they don't have to act. And it's essential that we take on, as our two top global priorities, those two industries. Those are the two above all else that are driving us to destruction. Because where livestock is concerned, it's not just a major source of climate emissions. It is the major cause of ecological destruction on Earth. It is the thing above all other factors that is tipping Earth systems into destruction. And so getting out of livestock farming is the number one priority. And there are some very interesting new means which will make it easier to do that. I mean, I would love it if everyone became a vegan like me, but I recognize that's not going to happen, or not purposefully going to happen. But we can create ways in which everyone becomes a vegan, even without really realizing that they've become a vegan, which is part of the aim. And we can talk later if you want. I know we're sort of, this is a slightly less technical discussion. I mean, last night got really techie. It was great. It was brilliant that it got techie. But if you want to get techie, we can get techie. Mm-hmm. But just broadly sketching out, you know, we can shift the production of high protein foods off the farm altogether, because we have these extraordinary new means now of producing them from microbes instead. And you know, people might be resistant to that idea, but we can shrink the footprint of farming, of food production, down to a dot. We can release the vast majority of the land that we use for mass ecological restoration, for rewilding, which is our last best hope now of preventing the collapse of Earth systems. We have to stop the sixth great extinction. We have to stop ecological breakdown, Earth systems breakdown, climate breakdown. And the only way we can realistically do it now is by rewilding a huge portion of the planet. And getting out of livestock farming is the best way of creating that opportunity. But even within the farming, we will still have to do, because we'll still have to have grain. We need to grow grain. We need to grow fruit and vegetables. It occupies by far the minority of the area of farmland, because livestock occupies the most. That needs radical change as well, because of the pesticides, the fertilizers, the water being used to grow those crops, the plowing, which is ripping the soil apart. All these issues are existential issues. All of them threaten Earth systems. And there are some fascinating solutions to those as well. Just to give one example, the potential to switch from growing annual crops to growing perennial crops. Now, annual plants, which live and die within 1 year, annual plants covering large areas are quite rare in nature, and they generally only occur like that in the aftermath of an ecological disaster, a volcanic eruption, a major fire, a landslide. They like bare earth, and they are very good at colonizing bare ground. They spread their seeds quickly, they reproduce quickly, they occupy it for a year or two, and then the perennial plants, the long-lasting plants, come in and smother them. So in order to grow our annual grain crops, we have to create an ecological disaster every year. We have to plow the land, or we have to spray the land, and we have to make it bare, which is what they like. And then having sown the seeds, we have to pamper those seeds. We have to give them fertilizer. We have to give them water. We have to kill the pests, which might eat them, with pesticide. We have to kill the weeds with herbicide in order to bring these little plants up to maturity. Then we harvest them, and then the next year we start the whole process again. And the plowing required is breaking down soil at a horrendous rate. I mean, it's not sustainable. So if we could switch to perennial grain crops instead, we could massively reduce those impacts. And this has been a dream of scientists for over a century, but it's finally being realized. The Land Institute in Kansas has been scouring the world for potential perennial grain crops and has begun to find loads of them. One of them, in conjunction with Yunnan University in China, it's brought to full development. There's a romantically named short grain rice variety, PR23, which is a perennial short grain rice, which actually was quite simply achieved. It was a cross between a perennial rice species and annual short grain rice, and they managed to create perennial short grain rice. It's now fully commercialized, being grown widely in southern China. Farmers are desperate for the seed, because soil erosion is a huge issue there. The terraced paddy fields are falling off the hillsides because they've been overplowed, but also because they're very short of labor. A lot of the young people are left for the cities. So if you don't have to plant it every year, you know, if you can keep it in the field year after year, you've massively reduced your labor bill. And the these crops now have been grown for several years and are still producing the same yield as annual rice. I've eaten it. It is just short grain rice. It's the same thing. And there's a whole series of other crops they're now bringing forward which can replace annual grain crops, greatly reduce the workload in producing grain, but also greatly reduce the environmental load. And I've eaten some of the other crops as well. They're excellent. It's good grain. And added to the likelihood that you can massively reduce environmental impact, you can also massively increase environmental resilience. And that's because these perennial crops have much deeper roots and much tougher structures above ground, so they're better able to withstand environmental shocks. So, for instance, the Land Institute is developing a kind of perennial sunflower to produce oil, and it was growing its sunflower block, perennial sunflowers, alongside a block of annual sunflowers. There was a big drought, completely wiped out the annual sunflowers, and the perennial sunflowers sailed through. And this is essential, that, you know, farming is more resilient because it is getting hit by bigger and bigger environmental shocks, which greatly compromise our ability to feed the world.
So what you're proposing now, what you're telling me about, it seems like there are basically no drawbacks to it. Is that true? And if that is true, why isn't it being done already by farmers?
I mean, there are drawbacks to everything. You know, there's no technology, there's no change, there's no approach, there's no system which doesn't have its drawbacks, which doesn't have some impact somewhere. And so, you know, we aren't seeking perfection here. We are seeking better, hopefully a lot better. Now, so the biggest issue they have to overcome is yield. Perennial crops don't put so much energy into seeds because they tend to put it into their roots and into their stems and their leaves instead. So you're looking for those rare instances where a perennial crop can give you a high yield. With the rice, they managed to achieve that. That's a complete success. It's greatly improved the environmental quality of rice growing without an impact on yield. And yields have to remain high. You know, the holy grail in farming has to be high yield, low impact. Because if yields aren't high, you get agricultural sprawl. In other words, you need to use more land to produce a given amount of food. And land should be the number one environmental issue. You know, we've massively neglected it. The only time we talk about land, really, consistently as environmentalists, is with urban sprawl. Right? And urban sprawl is a big problem. You know, urban sprawl, we should be campaigning against it. It's bad for cities, it's bad for the countryside. But all the building on Earth occupies just 1% of the land surface. All our homes, all our businesses, all our infrastructure is 1%. A lot of it shouldn't be there. You know, it should be less than 1%. But that's what it is. Whereas farming occupies 38% of the planet, which is all the planet, which isn't forest-protected areas, deserts, mountains, and ice. And in fact, it's now gravely threatening the remaining forests and protected areas. And so we have to minimise the land footprint, because every hectare we use for our extractive purposes, and by far the biggest is farming, and by far the biggest component of that is livestock farming, is a hectare we can't use to support wild ecosystems. Forests, wetlands, savannas, wild grasslands, at sea, if we're trawling all the seas, we can't have functioning sea floors and reefs and kelp forests and mangroves and all the rest of it. So, you know, and wild ecosystems are absolutely essential to our survival and the survival of most of life on Earth. The great majority of species require wild ecosystems for their survival. So we should be minimizing our land footprint. But at the same time, we should be minimizing inputs. You know, farming is too intensive in some places and too extensive in other places. You know, we need farming which is going to give us the yields that intensive farming gives us, but without the intensive use of chemicals and water and ploughing and the other inputs. Now, so that's why perennial grain yields need to be high. That's a difficulty. That's been one of the issues which is hardest to overcome, but they seem to be getting there. I mean, they've overcome it completely with this rice variety. There's several others in the pipeline which are pretty close now. Yields are rising very fast as they do their selective breeding and pick out the high-yielding cultivars to then breed from. There are other issues. For instance, there's one or two crops which are very promising in some ways, but you know, when you want to change your crop, because they don't last forever in the ground, some of them are really persistent and difficult to get rid of. So, you know, you say, oh, this is a great crop while it's growing, but then, oh, what do we do about the fact that it keeps coming up amongst the new crops we're trying to grow? So, you know, nothing is perfect, but we, you know, they've got thousands of potential crops and varieties to choose from. And so out of that, there will be some which can replace the arable crops we currently use.
Mm. So that's the changing out the crops for perennial variants is one of the things. And the other one, did you mention how many of those 37% of the farmland was used for grazing?
Sure,
for
thank
food
you. Yes.
Production
no,
for animals.
It's a very important point. So, 38%. The latest figures we have. Of that, 12% of the land surface is used for growing crops. And roughly half the land used for growing crops is used for growing crops for animal feed. So it's only about 7% of the land surface which is used to grow crops directly for humans. Now, when you grow crops for animal feed, you lose most of the nutritional value of those crops, because passing them through an animal, the animal metabolizes, it respires, it has to make body parts which we don't eat, and so we lose a lot of that food value. But what about the remaining 26%? What accounts for that? That's all grazing land. That's all your cattle and sheep grazing outdoors, which produce just a tiny fraction of the food we eat. This is a phenomenally profligate and wasteful way of producing food. And there's a huge livestock industry greenwashing exercise going on at the moment. Massive propaganda to say it's regenerative ranching, formerly known as ranching. They've just slapped this word regenerative in front of everything. It's a bit like the word sustainable. You know, you just carry on business as usual, but you stick one of those words in front of it, job done.
Yeah.
End of story. And it's like having regenerative coal. It's the exact opposite of a regenerative system. That agricultural sprawl caused by pastured meat production is the worst thing of all that we are doing to the planet, because of the huge ecological opportunity cost and carbon opportunity cost. And an opportunity cost means what you could otherwise be doing if you weren't doing this. So by occupying that land for livestock grazing, you ensure it cannot be occupied by wild ecosystems. And those wild ecosystems are not just far richer in biological abundance and diversity, they're also far richer in carbon than the pastures that you are replacing. So we've got to, just as the fossil fuel industry was promoting clean coal a few years ago and was saying CO2 is plant food, so the more we produce, the greener the world will become. This is exactly now what they're doing with grazing. The livestock industry is pursuing a very similar greenwashing, climate denial, PR campaign. And shockingly, some environmentalists have fallen for this and are reproducing the claims. You know, they've found themselves quite accidentally on the other side, aligning with the livestock industry against other environmentalists, because this is very persuasive propaganda. You know, the most persuasive form has been the TED talk given by Alan Savory, which has now got a warning on it saying this is not scientifically supported. But it's been watched 11 million times. People love the story he tells. Livestock can sequester carbon. They can restore ecosystems. It's bullshit. Mm-hmm. It just, none of it stacks up. None of the major claims in his talk are empirically supported by scientific evidence. And in fact, the photos he showed, which seemed to show this great recovery of the land when you intensively graze it with livestock, none of them are labeled. The ones people have been able to trace, they've found two, which actually show what happens when you take the livestock off the land. It's the exact opposite of what he was claiming to show. And, you know, I'm not saying he's doing this deliberately. You know, he's a nice guy. I've spoken to him. You know, he's quite sweet in some ways, but he's got it wrong. You know, he's a livestock farmer, and you get this motivated reasoning kicks in. You know, you want to believe certain things, and so that's the line you go down.
Yeah, you've also mentioned before the sort of romanticization of grazing livestock and the idea of how we have this sort of farming livestock Illuminati trying to indoctrinate our children.
Yeah, yeah.
Paraphrasing loosely, yeah. not that far off. What do you think? Why do you think that is? Why do you think we're so attached to the idea of this romantic farming image that doesn't really exist in reality?
And this is a very deeply embedded theme. It's so deeply embedded that we don't even recognize it as an idea, as a thought. It's just there inside us. This is part of our culture. And it goes back a very long way. So in the secular tradition, it goes back to Theocritus, born in Sicily, then moved to Alexandria, and was looking back from Alexandria to his native Sicily in the 3rd century BC and romanticizing nostalgically the life of the shepherds there. I don't know if he'd ever actually seen a shepherd, but he created this ideal, this idea, this bucolic, he called it. He called it his bucolics, of these shepherds sitting under the trees all day, telling stories, playing music, having sex with each other. There's loads of sex in Theocritus, but somehow this was the seat of purity and innocence among these shepherds. And the city where he was, Alexandria, was the cauldron of evil and corruption. And this then becomes a very powerful cultural theme. It's picked up by Virgil. He moves the action to Arcadia in Greece, Pan's realm, overseeing the shepherds. And again, he sort of uses it in a slightly more political, satirical way. The good shepherd is the good ruler. The good subjects are the good sheep who just follow him around meekly like sheep. And then there were very similar themes in the religious tradition. So in the Old Testament, you had the books were written by the descendants of herders. They were people living in the city and looking back nostalgically to the herding life. Woe to the bloody city, it is all lies and deception, the prey departeth not, said Nahum, you know, one of the prophets in the Old Testament. And that's a sort of very strong theme, you know, Sodom and Gomorrah, the evil city, and the innocent herding life. And, you know, it's affronted innocence is a big part of that story. Going back to Cain and Abel, because Cain was the enemy, the tiller of the ground. And Abel, the beloved of God, was the herder of beasts. And the tiller of the ground, the settled person, kills the herder of beasts, the livestock farmer. Mm. And then Jesus comes along and he's simultaneously the good shepherd and Agnus Dei, the Lamb of God. And he tells his disciples, feed my sheep. And so I believe you use the word pastor in Swedish. Mm-hmm. Your priest is the pastor. Pastor is Latin for shepherd. Mm-hmm. The pastoral staff in the Western Church remains in the shape of the shepherd's crook. And so this is very deep cultural themes, which then got picked up by the Renaissance poets, by Dante, by Petrarch, by Boccaccio, by other Southern European Renaissance poets. I don't know about Sweden, but in England it became a very big thing with Edmund Spenser's The Shepherd's Calendar, Mary Herbert, Christopher Marlowe, William Shakespeare, and many others. Their pastoral eclogues and bucolics and mimes became a very strong theme in English culture. And then it sort of goes to sleep for a couple of hundred years and comes roaring back in the 20th century with books, as you say, for very young children, for pre-literate children. And about half of those books, I'm sure every parent has seen them. I mean, it's a remarkably high proportion of those books for very, very young children are about livestock farms. But not livestock farms that bear any relationship to what livestock farms actually look like. One rosy cheek farmer, one cow, one sheep, one horse, one cat, one chicken, and they all talk to each other and live in harmony together like a family, and there's no indication of why they might be there or where they might be going. And that becomes embedded in our souls. And when, as a teenager, I worked on a farm, which turned out to be an intensive pig farm. You know, I went there naively. You know, I knew it wasn't going to be quite like in the storybooks, but I thought it might be a bit like in the storybooks. And it could not be more different. It's the polar opposite. They create this picture of this safe and comfortable space, this sort of lovely, warm image. It's hell. An intensive pig farm is an image out of hell. And if we treated our cats and dogs like we treat pigs and chickens, we would be sent to prison. And so we live with this cognitive dissonance. You know, oh, we love animals, we're animal lovers, you know, and people are genuine animal lovers. But this stuff on our plate, you know, that's something else entirely. You know, we don't want to know where it comes from. We don't want to think about it at all. You know, you can't visit an intensive livestock farm. You know, they won't let you in. You can't visit a slaughterhouse. You know, and people actively don't want to know. So there was a survey in the United States, right, where 95% of people eat meat. 47% of people in this survey wanted to ban slaughterhouses.
So what you suggest as an alternative in this book to sort of a plant-based diet for everyone, is fermented proteins used to make replacements for animal products. Why are you going down that route rather than saying, oh, we already have meat replacement alternatives?
What is
the big difference and why is it important?
So I mean, speaking for myself, I feel no need to eat anything that's like meat. Or even cheese. Actually, it's an amazing thing. When you go vegan, you suddenly don't want to eat a lot of that stuff anymore. Maybe there are one or two things. You know, there are a few weaknesses, I admit. But, you know, where you think, oh, God, if I just what? No. You know, you sort of get tempted. But so cheese, for instance, I used to love cheese. I used to love all the different kinds of cheese. And the stinkier, the better. And I thought, how could I give up cheese? You know, because I'd seen the damage the dairy industry was doing, you know, and it was mostly for environmental reasons, the absolute catastrophe it's causing, where it's killing rivers everywhere. And I just thought, you know, how could I live without this? But weirdly, within 2 weeks of giving it up, it was like the brain plays a trick, and it's sort of suddenly, cheese, it's just a lump of fat. I don't want to eat that. And you sort of feel disgusted by it. It's a really strange thing. But anyway, most people aren't like me.
sadly. I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful if everyone was? But no, but all those weird people want to carry on eating animal products. And that is the great majority of the world's population, you know, and veganism is rising, but slowly. Meat eating is rising very fast. You know, people talk about the population crisis, right? Mm-hmm. And they mean the human population crisis. But actually, human population is about the only environmental indicator that's plateauing. Yeah, it's still rising, but by only 1% a year. That's come down from 2% a year in the 1960s, and it's going to hit a plateau about mid-century. So it's doing this, whereas every other environmental indicator is doing that. But there is a genuine population crisis. It's the livestock population crisis, because while humans are growing at 1% a year, livestock is growing at 2.4% a year. To put it in crude terms, by 2050, on the current trajectory, there will be 100 million tons of extra human being on Earth and 400 million tons of extra livestock on Earth. Already, only 4% of mammals on Earth by weight are wild. 36% of the weight of mammals is humans and 60% is livestock. And, you know, if we carry on the way we're going, there'll be no wild mammals left at all. It's apart from a few rats, perhaps, you know, but all the rest is going to be livestock. You know, they're taking over the planet. So we have to stop that trend. I mean, it will kill us all. It will be the end of life on Earth if we allow that to continue. We can't. And so we have to find substitutes which are very similar or ideally indistinguishable from animal products with a tiny fraction of the environmental footprint and which are cheaper, because this will be won on price. Mm-hmm. And we already have massively improving plant substitutes for animal products. Some of them are really rubbish. Some of them are very good. Last night at the Choo Choo restaurant, I ate for the first time a 3D created steak made by a company in Slovenia and cooked beautifully by this restaurant. And honestly, I would never have been able to tell it wasn't meat. It had the texture, the fibrous texture of meat. Everything about it was screaming meat at me. And I was like, oh, wait a minute. Is someone pulling my leg here? Because I think I'm eating a bit of cow, because it was quite remarkable. But this is, and that's made entirely with plants. But, you know, we can make it so much easier and with much fewer ingredients and less processing and all the rest of it. If we can make it from the same proteins and fats that meat is made from. And you can use microbes to produce those same proteins and fats. And so they've done the difficult bit, which is the structure. I thought getting the structure right was going to be last in line. That was going to be the hardest bit. But this Slovenian company called Juicy Marbles has already achieved that. They've cracked the structure issue, the hardest bit. And so the ingredients is actually a lot easier than that, because we've been using precision fermentation, which is just a refined form of brewing, for many years. I mean, since 1978, to make insulin. And if anyone's a diabetic in the audience, the insulin they're using will come from precision fermentation, from microbes producing that specific chemical. We've been using it since the 1980s to produce chymosin, which is a substitute for the rennet that came from the fourth stomach of an unweaned calf, which was used to coagulate milk into cheese. And if you eat cheese, you're almost certainly eating chymosin. We use it to produce vitamins. If you have any food with extra vitamins in, or you take vitamin supplements, that's where it comes from. But now the big breakthrough is using it to produce protein and fat. And we're going to see digital-style cost curves. It's going to get cheap very, very quickly. And we can produce the specific proteins and fats found in meat, found in fish, found in milk, found in eggs. And once that happens, you know, very quickly, these substitutes for those products are going to become effectively identical to those products. It's not going to be possible to tell them apart. And soon after that, they will become cheaper. And that is what's going to drive the end of the livestock industry.
Hmm. So again, I'll ask the same thing again then, because what you're describing now is a process that will take up less land. Mm-hmm. It will be less reliant on water and changes in climate. It will be more robust,
yes,
as I understand it. So what's the drawback? Why aren't people doing it?
Thank you. Okay, so first of all, yes, that's... I mean, there are two amazing things this delivers. One, it can shrink the environmental footprint of protein-rich foods to a dot. So there's a Swedish scientist called Thomas Linder who calculated what you could do if you were to produce these precision products from methanol metabolizing bacteria. So there are some bacteria which eat hydrogen or eat methanol. And you can make that from renewable electricity. You don't need any agricultural feedstocks at all to make those products, and you can do so on a tiny proportion of the land area. And he calculated that growing the protein in those microbial breweries by those means would use 1,700 times less land than growing soy, which is currently the most efficient way of producing protein from agriculture. And that means, if you compare soy production to beef production, you would use 138,000 times less land than beef production uses for a given amount of protein. And this is the most radical, the most important environmental technology ever developed, because it allows us to rewild huge tracts of the planet. And that is the only thing now that's going to save humanity and save us from Earth systems collapse. Mm. It's the absolutely crucial environmental technology. But there are drawbacks. Yes, you're quite right. Of course there are. The biggest threat is corporate capture. Now, this isn't a new threat, because the corporations have already captured the food chain, right? Mm. Four corporations control 90% of the global grain trade. Mm. It's terrifying. It's highly destabilizing. It's terrible for food security, for food sovereignty, for everything. It's a really, really dangerous thing that's happened there. And we've let this happen. How? You know, this is outrageous. Where's the antitrust laws? Mm. Yeah, the governments are not moving against these corporations. And we have to break that stranglehold, whether it's in the old food economy or the new food economy. But, you know, do you conclude that because four corporations control the global grain trade, we should stop the global grain trade? Because if you did, billions of people would starve very, very quickly. You'd cause mass starvation. No, we must break up the corporations. And so in developing these new foods, we must ensure that it can't become concentrated as the existing food economy has become. So there must be strong antitrust laws. There must be weak intellectual property rights. We need open source technologies. And that shouldn't be hard, because a lot of this has been developed by universities with public money. Do we allow corporations just to walk off with the intellectual property? No, we should not allow that. These are all political choices. You know, humans made these systems. Humans can change these systems. This is a great gift to humanity, which comes along at exactly the time when we need it. Let's not give it to a bunch of corporations. Let's make this a socialized form of business. There are plenty around, even in high-tech businesses, like community broadband, like local energy cooperatives. We can do the same with these technologies. There could be a brewery in every town, producing protein-rich foods to meet local tastes. And that's the other amazing thing which this technology gives you. As well as massively shrinking the environmental footprint, it can break the dangerous dependency of many nations on the global trade in food, which is becoming less and less secure, more and more disrupted by geopolitical shocks, by environmental shocks in particular, by bottlenecking, and by the loss of systemic resilience caused by corporate control and consolidation. And countries which have become totally dependent on imports in Middle East, in North Africa, Horn of Africa, Central America, many other parts, particularly in the poorer nations, are completely dependent on imports for survival. Many don't have enough fertile land or water of their own. Could break that dependency by producing their protein-rich foods by precision fermentation. Because if your feedstock is hydrogen or methanol, all you need is sunlight. And one thing that most food insecure countries have is lots of sunlight.
Yeah.
And so you can break that dependency. You can produce unlimited quantities of food with minimal inputs, without relying on this highly unreliable global economy. You can operate without being connected to the rest of that economy, and that liberates people from the grip of those big corporations.
So you're mentioning this that one of the important things for this is that the technology for it needs to be open source. Do you think that that in itself has become a problem for getting political support for this? Or where do you think it gets stuck? Because it's
the real sticking points, particularly in Europe, are at the regulatory level, because it's like the novel foods regulations, they can be parked indefinitely. And so what happens is that someone applies for novel food permit, like Solar Foods in Helsinki has done it. And then all the corporate lobbyists from the livestock industry who feel threatened by this, and they should, then plant all these objections against approval for that food. And then the European Commission can say, oh, it's all very complicated, let's just park this. And even though the novel foods regulations is meant to be a two-year period, you can just suspend the whole thing indefinitely. And corporate lobbyists use this very effectively. In other jurisdictions, it happens much quicker. So, for instance, Solar Foods, the same company in Helsinki, within a very short amount of time got permission to sell this product in Singapore, but who knows how long it's going to take in the European Union. We've got to see what's happening here. This is corporate lobbying, which is preventing competition.
So if I was an activist, let's say, or even more importantly, if I was part of the media, which I am, where would I start to question these things? Because I know you've been really critical of the way the media handles, I guess, environmentalism in general. Do you want to expand a bit on that and explain why?
So if you were to ask me, which is the greater threat to life on Earth, fossil fuel industry or the media? I'd say the media. the lovely industry I work for, and we both work for, with obvious glowing exceptions.
Present company excluded.
Present company excepted. And this is because it's the media that grants the social license to operate to the fossil fuel companies, to the livestock industry, to the chemicals industry, to the plastic industry, to all the other things which together are trashing the living world. And without the cover that the media gives these industries, without the endless justification and normalization of the horrendous things that these industries do, they could not continue to operate. And there's a similar cover in politics, because these industries buy consent. They purchase political consent. You need only use a very small amount of your profit to buy all the politicians and all the politics you want. You can order them online. There's a price list. Politicians are very easy to buy. You don't actually necessarily have to give them a wad of cash in a brown envelope, but you fund their campaign for re-election. You fund their political party, or you threaten them. You say, if you don't give us what we want, we will lobby against you and make your life very difficult. And the corporations which are most effective at doing that are, of course, the media. And the media are part of this industrial complex which tries to maintain business as usual. Now, in some cases, it's very obvious why. The cases where the media is owned by billionaires, and if you're going to own a major media company, you need to be a billionaire. And you become a billionaire because the current system is one that you can exploit and extract money from. And so any threat to that system, any threat to business as usual, is a threat to your status as a billionaire. And so you will fight that threat as hard as the fossil fuel industries will fight. And you will tell governments or political parties, if you go against the current economic system, we will destroy you. And they genuinely do, particularly in the UK, where we've got this highly concentrated media. So the three billionaires who own most of our newspapers are more powerful than the entire electorate of our nation. If they say no, it doesn't happen. If we say no, it can still happen, like with the Iraq war, for instance. You know, almost everyone said no, it happened. But if the billionaires and all Rupert Murdoch's 247 papers around the world mysteriously, by spontaneously supported the Iraq war, you know, they all came to the same conclusion, miraculously, that the Iraq war was a great idea. And if he says it's going ahead, it's going ahead, whatever we say. So they're a profound threat, both to democracy and to the living planet. I mean, the most dangerous thing on Earth is money in politics. That is what's killing the planet. And any campaign for democracy or for the protection of life on Earth must start with campaigning to get the money out of politics. Mm.
So, I totally lost my train of thought there for a second. We were talking about this yesterday, and obviously we're speaking a lot about the technology around it, and it's really complex for a lot of reasons. Obviously, you've written a whole book about it that you can read. And I know that Emma is going to talk a bit more about what you can do as sort of an individual to help this along. But how positive or optimistic do you feel about the chances of actually getting any of this done in time?
Thank you. No, this is the crucial question right across the board. You know, whatever the issue we're dealing with, that is the question. How do we make it happen? And so we start by spelling out our theory of change. And actually, the movements, the grassroots movements like Fridays for Future have been pretty good at that. The big environmental organizations, the established organizations, have been really bad at that. And they don't seem to have a theory of change, or not an articulated one. But if you press them, what they say is, well, we don't have time for system change, right? I've been working on these issues for 37 years now, and throughout that 37 years, I've been told, we don't have time for system change. We never had time for anything except system change. That's the only thing which can bring us to where we need to be. And so instead they say, well, we've got to, you know, we mustn't offend people, and we must try to reach those people who are furthest away from us, so we must meet them halfway. But of course, those people furthest away from us, the fascists, they don't stay where they are. They go further and further and further away from them. And so we're constantly running to catch up, saying, oh, hang on a minute. No, we're not, you know, we're not really against you. We just need to talk. We just need to talk. Yeah, okay, we'll say this so you'll listen to us. And we follow them. And so everything moves towards this disastrous position, which you in Sweden are very well aware of.
Yes.
And while we have been saying we don't have time for system change, the other side has changed everything. Mm-hmm. You know, when Mrs. Thatcher came to power in 1979, she said, economics is the method. The aim is to change the heart and the soul. She changed our politics. She changed our economics. She changed society. She changed culture. She changed us. She changed the whole system. She and the people around her, the neoliberals around her. And they destroyed the system, and now they let the fascists in. Right? But at all that time, we were saying, oh, we shouldn't ask for too much. You know, we should, you know, we can't offend people. You never get anywhere by trying to persuade the person in the opposite corner. That is not our role. That's not how change happens. So here's my theory of change, right? And you know, as you'll know from reading the book, I'm obsessed with systems theory. One of the great gaps in our education is we're not taught about complex systems unless we do specialist degrees. And I'm lucky enough that I had ecology as part of my degree, and you can't study ecology without understanding complex systems. And everything in life that's important is a complex system. Human brain, human body, human society, every ecosystem, the oceans, the atmosphere, the financial system, the food system, they're all complex systems. They all operate on the same mathematical rules. And they're not at all the same as how we're told systems operate, because we're taught about simple systems with like circuit diagrams. This is how it works. It's not how it works. It's completely different, and it's totally counterintuitive. And one of the consistent properties of all systems, complex systems, is that they have tipping points. They don't change in linear and gradual ways. They absorb stress, they absorb stress, they absorb stress, and then they collapse into a completely different equilibrium state. And when we're talking about environmental systems, that collapse is catastrophe for us. Social systems, that collapse can be our salvation, if we can get them to collapse into a different social state. And we also now know, and in fact we know a lot more about social complex systems than we do about some other complex systems, because we know where the tipping points are. And there's a large body now of empirical research, both observational and experimental, showing that the tipping point is about 25% penetration of a new idea or a new perspective. And if you can reach 25% of the population with that, that's the only people you need to reach. So our aim is not to persuade your fascist brother-in-law sitting in the opposite corner. You're never going to do so. And you just have furious arguments, and neither of you will ever persuade the other person. We preach to the choir, because they're the only people who listen, but we make the choir a little bit bigger every time. We expand those concentric circles a little more every week until we hit that 25%, and then society tips. So the golden example of this, which is an example I constantly draw on because they got it exactly right, was the marriage equality campaign by gay rights campaigners, which was a textbook example of how to do it. They didn't try to persuade the people in the opposite corner who were saying, marriage equality will be the end of civilization as we know it. If gay people are allowed to marry, I'm leaving the country. There's no point in arguing with those people. What's the point? You're just going to get furious and upset and it's going to be horrible. No point. Just ignore those people. Which they did, and through a combination of a brilliant, really brilliant campaigning of all sorts, direct action, written campaigning, every kind of campaigning, they did it beautifully. They just expanded the social circle of acceptance of that idea. They built up their sort of infrastructure of their social infrastructure. And they hit that 25%, and across Western Europe, it just went like a wave. Bang, 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 bang. Marriage equality legislation. Country after country after country. And those people in the opposite corner then started saying, well, of course, I've always believed in marriage equality. Mm. And they believe it. They believe it. They were never persuaded. They just went along with the social wind. Once it had changed, they tacked round to catch it. No one wants to be left behind. Mm. Almost everyone, almost all the time, sides with the status quo, whatever it might be. Now, that's normally a bad thing, but it can be a very good thing if you can change the status quo. And then everyone thinks they are on your side. Like, after the war, everyone became a member of the resistance, right? Because they don't want to be seen as the bad guy. And so persuasion is greatly overrated as a political tool. We are not trying to persuade our opponents. If you try to do that you go nowhere. We need to raise the number of people who are on our side until we reach a quarter of society. That's all we need to do. It's much closer than we think. And indeed, there was a study showing the trajectory of Fridays for Future up to the end of 2019, showing it came very close to that 25% point. We were so close to a political tipping point right across Europe, with sort of green policies just on the cusp of coming, and then the pandemic came. And we had to all go home and start all over again. So it's intensely frustrating, but it's also very hopeful, because it shows how close we came, how close we can get again. We can do this. It's much more within our grasp than we think. But because we've had the wrong theory of change, because we've been thinking we need to persuade everyone, we think it's far out of our grasp. It's a long way away. But once you understand how society tips, when you understand what the processes are, then suddenly you can see change is not only possible. If we get the right strategy and continue to pursue it, change is inevitable.
So, since we're on the subject, sort of, unfortunately, on sort of the rise of the populist right in most of the world, most of the West at least, I've noticed that lately there's been a lot of aggression from that sort of corner of the of the political spectrum towards environmentalists and towards activists. Is that something that you've experienced as well? Why do you think that is?
No, I've never encountered it.
No, I figured.
my life is all peace and light. oh boy. Yeah, well, yes, of course. I mean, it's, you know, and especially with issues like meat. You know, meat has become a big deal now for the far right. You know, it's a, out of my cold dead hands, this is my steak. And meat is very closely associated with conventional notions of masculinity, you know, and it's like, I am a meat eater, you're a soy boy. I mean, I get called soy boy every day. Yeah, soy boy! So it's like that's the worst insult, you know. Mm-hmm. You can deal to someone, you're a soy boy, and you know what we're seeing here, you know, is a weaponized culture war. Right now, it wasn't the far right which developed these culture wars. What we have is you know, the dominant force in society for many, many years now, for 40 years or so, has been neoliberalism, which is this doctrine that, you know, it's all individual responsibility, everything must be devolved to the market, democracy must take second place to market forces, governments shouldn't govern, we shouldn't try to change social outcomes, we should cut the state, we should cut social security, we should cut public services, and if people sink, well, that's their fault, because they're unenterprising, they deserve to go down. And you can tell whom the light of God shines upon because they've got the money. They're the good people. They deserve the money. And those who don't have the money, they're the undeserving poor. That's what neoliberalism has been telling us for 40 years. So neoliberalism can't solve any of our problems. It's designed not to solve our problems. And it can only create inequality and poverty and indeed destitution, which is where we're going, right? Now, when you've got a system that does that, you have to offer people something. And one thing you can offer them, which you can't improve their lives because your system can't improve people's lives, but you have to offer them something else. So one thing you can offer them is those people are worse off than you. And we are going to performatively beat those people up to show that they are lower in the social pecking order than you so you can feel better about yourself. That's what we do with refugees. Yeah, and that's how the standard neoliberal parties, that's why they treat refugees so appallingly, to perform to the rest of society and say, you're better off than these people. These are the people who are to blame for all your problems. And look, you are licensed to beat them up and to think badly of them, and therefore you think better of yourself. Right, it's positional politics. It's a very long tried and trusted approach. But also, they have to launch culture wars, and culture wars are a way of distracting people from inequality. But as soon as you open that gate, the culture wars gate, that's when you let the fascists in, because there's no one better at culture wars than fascists. That's what they do. That's what fascism is all about. And fascism comes along and says, we've come to save you. We've come to save you from the corruption of politics, from those politicians who never answer any of your needs and are dominated by these people who want to control your lives. So hand it over to us. And instead of that corruption and that control of your life, we'll show you real corruption and control of your life. And always, behind every fascist, there's a billionaire quietly saying, oh, yeah, pretty good, you know. And they, the fascists, claim to be against the big money, but the big money always sits behind them. Yeah. And that's because, you know, fascism disguises the real sources of political oppression. It disguises the power behind the political economy. And so as soon as you get into that game, as a sort of normal right-wing neoliberal government, normal, none of them are actually normal, but as soon as you start to play that game of culture wars, someone's going to come along who can do it better than you. And the fascists do it better than the neoliberals do. And the neoliberals open the gate to fascism because they're not solving people's problems and because they're scapegoating other people. And so then the experts at scapegoating and the experts at culture wars say, great, we're on home ground now, we can mop up. That's what they've done in Sweden.
Mm. So I think it was in one of the interviews that I listened to preparing for this, you were speaking about how the way forward as activists or as people who want to change the world is to do it through a restoration story, which I thought was quite interesting as a concept. Can you tell us a bit about that? So, you know, we must
be true to the facts. We must be true to the science. We must become numerate. You know, we've become energy numerate. We're pretty good at that. Now we must become food numerate, and we must become everything numerate. Just as we know, if you burn a certain amount of fossil fuel, you're going to release a certain amount of carbon. It's going to produce a certain amount of global heating. We must know, for instance, with food, if you eat a certain diet, it's going to use this much land. It's going to cause this much environmental destruction. And it's well documented now, but most people aren't aware of it. So, you know, the facts are crucial. But no one was ever persuaded by a stream of facts. If you just throw data at them, it's not going to work. You need to tell a story. You know, if you want to expand that social circle, you've got to tell a story. And the story which works best in politics and in political and religious revolution, and has done for thousands of years, is a narrative structure that I call the restoration story. Now, people argue over how many basic plots there are. You know, they say there's three basic plots, or there's five, or there's seven, or there's nine. It's always an odd number for some reason. But everyone agrees that one of those basic plots, and perhaps the most successful of all the basic plots, is this story. And the story goes as follows. The world has been thrown into disorder by powerful and nefarious interests working against the interest of humanity. But the hero or heroes will stand up and fight those powerful and nefarious interests, overthrow them, and restore harmony to the land. That's the narrative structure of the restoration story. And you cannot succeed in politics or in religion, if you want a religious transformation, without telling a version of that restoration story. That's the trigger. That's what makes people sit up and go, a story that tells me where we are, why we're there, what we need to do, and where we need to end up. That's what a story does. It gives you a political trajectory, and a political trajectory gives you hope. And in politics, a gram of hope is worth a ton of despair. Right? And it's a story which gives you that trajectory of hope that takes you from where you are to where you need to be. So we must embed our scientific facts. We must embed our knowledge within the arc of a restoration narrative. So in a situation like this, with food, for instance, it's an easy story to tell. The world has been thrown into disorder, the disorder of environmental collapse, by powerful and nefarious forces, the livestock industry, which are operating against the interests of humanity, not hard to demonstrate. But the heroes of the story, and I think there's some in the audience, will confront these powerful forces and against the interests, overthrow them with the help of the following technologies and approaches and restore harmony to the land. What does that look like? The mass restoration of ecosystems, drawing down carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, stopping the sixth great extinction, a world in which both humans and non-human life can thrive. That's our story.
So I know we have about 15 minutes before they drag us out of here by the scruff of our necks or something. So I'm thinking we should sort of round this up. I know Emma will want to come and say some things about this campaign. But if you could take some time to explain what you think are the most important steps an individual can take. Because you mentioned this yesterday and I thought it was really...
Thank you. A really good thing to take away. Another crucial issue. So the first thing is that none of the most important steps are the ones we take as individuals. You know, part of the thrust, the drive of neoliberalism has been to individuate us. Interestingly, actually, fascism goes in the opposite direction. It aims to bring us together as an almost indistinguishable mass of humanity around a common identity. So it's we've got these two disastrous poles in politics. But actually, you know, we need to operate, we need to work together to fight systemic problems. You can't do that as an individual. They're constantly trying to tell us you are a consumer. And they want us to see ourselves as consumers because as consumers we have very little power. as it happens, there are two things we can do as consumers which make a big difference. One, switch to a plant-based diet. Right? And two, stop flying. Those are the two biggest things we can do as individuals. But all the other things we do, we have to do together, because you know we're fighting huge political structures. We're fighting systems which are destroying Earth systems, political systems that are destroying environmental systems. And we need to reach the social tipping point before we hit the environmental tipping point, right? And we can only do that together. So today I dropped in on the Aurora event outside the Swedish Parliament and met some of the heroes there, including my greatest hero. I think you can guess who it is. and it was, you know, that's what gives me hope. That's what shows me that we can get, you know, we've got this. We can do this. We can make change inevitable, because I see these people, predominantly in this case young people, mobilizing so effectively and getting together and pressing their demands and attacking the system, in this case with a legal challenge, you know, mounting a systemic challenge to a systemic problem. Mm. Yeah, and that's what we need to do. You know, we use the tools, every tool in the box. You know, it's not, you know, we just do this one thing. So, you know, we need the legal tools like Aurora are doing. We need the political tools. We need the social tools, the cultural tools, also the technological tools. Not one of those by itself can give us our answer. They are all necessary but insufficient conditions. But you bring them all together and then you get systemic change. And we can do this. We are doing this, but we can't do it if we believe we are consumers, if we call ourselves consumers, if we accept that description. No. Our moral duty is to be citizens. It is as citizens that we are powerful.
Do you want to do your thing now?
I can do my thing.
Yeah. I was just wondering, because I know that if we take another question, we never know where we end up, you know? So, Emma here is from WePlanet. And your organization is sort of making sure this is happening. So can you please tell us a bit about what you're doing?
Yeah, sure. A microphone out of a champagne bucket. That's not the most fun thing I've ever taken out of a champagne bucket. But it is one reason for celebrating. And what we're hearing today is a future of food. It's a food revolution that is about to happen. And thank you so much, Mira, and thank you so much, George. And thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. Yeah, yeah. Give yourselves a round of applause. Yeah, yeah. My name is Emma Smart. I am part of WePlanet, which is the organization that has dragged George around Europe over the last week giving these talks. We're a new organization. We are fighting for, and it is a fight, for a world where nature thrives, but also humanity thrives as well. There are many environmental organizations out there right now, but if signing petitions and campaigns and writing letters and going on marches worked, then we wouldn't currently be experiencing the sixth mass extinction. We currently wouldn't be heading for almost 3 degrees of global heating. Something has gone wrong in environmentalism and it needs a shake-up. And that's what WePlanet are here to do. So why are WePlanet different? We are led by the science, but we are inspired by direct action. We are pro-science activists. WePlanet want to see 50 to 75% of Europe rewilded. And to enable that to happen, we must transition away from animal agriculture. Yeah. WePlanet want to see clean energy so we can have global prosperity. We want to reboot food. There are leaflets on the chairs tonight for you to learn more about Reboot Food, our campaign. And ultimately, we want to set nature free. We want to reintroduce those lost species and rewild nature. So that's what attracted me to WePlanet. My background is in science. I spent 15 years in academia. I worked for a major NGO. I'm not going to pander around that subject, but I decided quite a long time ago that there's enough science out there, and that I'd always believed, maybe naively, that by producing science, by writing articles and reports and books, and they're all, obviously, we need the books and the reports, but newsflash, it's not enough. I always believed that those making the decisions would listen to the science, and they are not listening. So around 3.5 years ago, I moved from academia to activism. Why? Because when power and money speak louder than truth and science, these are the lengths that we must now go to. I have been arrested 17 times. Most recently, just 6 days ago, when David Attenborough happened to be in a local seafood restaurant following filming a series about marine wildlife, and I went to speak to him to ask him to use his platform now to speak about the crisis. Just 5 minutes. I've been listening to Sir David my entire life. 5 minutes of his time, and I was arrested. This time last year, I was serving a 4-month prison sentence for demanding the UK government insulate homes, its fundamental duty to protect citizens and reduce emissions. On this exact day last year, I was on day 9 of what would be a 26-day hunger strike, 1 day for every failed COP. My activism seems to have caught up with me here in Sweden. George and I had a meeting with the Minister of Environment today. They must have done a bit of a background check because I wasn't allowed in the building. I wish I was joking, I'm not. I'm a scientist, and I wasn't allowed in the Ministry of Environment to have a discussion about the ecological crisis. There were 3 security police officers outside guarding the building, and I was asked to leave the vicinity of the area.
And you weren't even going to glue yourself to the minister.
I had no glue on me. I was just going to talk, that's all. This is outrageous, but this is what we are facing now. It's an attack on our democracy. We see it more throughout Europe. Right now in the UK, there are 30 ordinary people in prison for environmental protest. And throughout Europe, I think 19 are in prison in Germany right now, including scientists. Our governments are choosing to imprison scientists rather than listen to them. So, this is why WePlanet is important. The environmental movement needs a massive shake-up. We need to be much more ambitious. We need to be much more radical. So tonight, I invite you, please join us at WePlanet. We have a branch here in Sweden, and we are growing. Please speak to me afterwards, or there's a Carolina here as part of WePlanet. We all have a duty and a responsibility. I, as a white woman in a Western country with an education, I have massive privilege, and I must use that. I must use that for the earth defenders around the world who are being murdered 2 to 3 a week by governments and corrupt organizations. We must use our voice for them. We must use our voice for children. They are too young. By the time they're old enough to protest or to vote, it will be too late. Not to mention the millions of non-human species who don't have a voice. We must use whatever privilege we have. I mean, all of us here, I have a privilege. There are people here who have a platform from which to speak. It is our duty and responsibility to use that platform. Yeah. There is no longer time for sitting on the fence. Silence is complicity. If you do not speak out in a crisis, then you are complicit. So my invitation to you tonight is to support WePlanet, to support activists. We were out there today. It was incredible with Aurora outside of the parliament. Do not just come to a talk and go away and think that was very interesting. Go away and think, what can I do? How can I contribute? You don't have to glue yourself to a motorway. You don't have to throw soup at a Van Gogh, but there's something that we can all do. We can all step up. So please do that. Use whatever platform and whatever privilege you have. So thank you all again for coming. It is time to reset the environmental movement. It is time to rewild. It is time to resist. It is time to replanet.
Yay.
Thank you very much. Woo. Thank you again, George, Amira.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. So, like you were saying, you will be upstairs for a bit. You will be upstairs for a bit. If you want to ask George something, if you want to ask Emma something, if you want to ask Carolina something, go upstairs and speak to them. And thank you all very much for attending tonight. And I hope that you go out and do great things.
Yay.
Of course.
Fantastic.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.